I'm not asking for the riches of the land. I'm not asking her for high men to know my name. Please give me, Lord, a clean heart that I may follow thee. Give me a clean heart, a clean heart, and I will follow thee. I'm sometime up and sometime I am down. I'm sometime on the level to the ground. Please give me, Lord, a clean heart that I may follow thee. Give me a clean heart, a clean heart, and I will follow thee. Give me a clean constituents were on their way here. Amen. And we yet pray for their safe arrival.
Amen.
As some of you would say, I would rather hear you say that I have arrived late than the late Brother Collins is here.
Yeah.
There is a difference.
Amen.
There is a difference. But in the meantime, let me say to those, there are times when I might seem hard, but I'm not hard-hearted. I recognize even in their absence, the officers of this, the West Virginia Baptist State Convention, Vice President Moore in his absence, Vice President Coleman in his absence. He's come in? All right, I took my glasses off. I'm still with him. I didn't see that far. Thank you. Brother Coleman is in the house. I got him over here. Thank you, and Vice President Dotson. trustee board, executive board, and all of the, our president, gave us some needful encouragement as well as direction. Now, let me just say with God, directions are no good if you're not willing to follow them.
Amen.
So she's given us some needful directions, not just to the women's auxiliary, but to this convention. And it would do us well to follow if we believe that they're God sent through her, those directions. Amen?
Amen.
To all of my, of the presidents, the auxiliaries, I once kept using the word and thought it might catch on ministries, but I was informed that they called auxiliaries. So I'll stay with that, auxiliary, but you know that you are still yet ministers. Amen?
Amen.
Always I greet you in the name of God our Father and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Executive Director leads and cares for this convention and all of its work and properties. Our Executive Director, Reverend Dr. Frank Jones, our President, our Secretary in his absence, James Red, and as I look out, I see a few members. My second vice president, moderator of our Flat Top Association, wave your hand, the Moore preached
a
great message on yesterday. I recognize him and a few of the members of Flat Top. Flat Top, if you're part of Flat Top, just stand up, please. Just stand up. Don't be ashamed of your association. Flat Top, if you'll stand up. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Just want to recognize, and then I thank our members of Mount Olive, Sister Burroughs, and of course my wife, Sister Collins. I thank God for those who share this platform with me, and I recognize our President, Sister Cooks, Vice President of our Women, Second Vice, right? Sister Robinson. Third Vice President of Prime Body, Reverend Dotson, God in heaven knows. Thank you for your prayers. You know what we've been through. But I thank God for my wife,
Amen.
Sharon.
Amen.
God put us together in holy matrimony at 56. Years ago. And I tell you, she is my helpmeet. She tells me when I should not have done what I've done. Amen. Now I'll go to my closet in the bathroom and sit down and suck for a minute. Then come and tell the baby, thank you.
Amen.
You need that.
Amen.
Amen. No good leader or no good pastor or no good man wants a yes person around all the time. Amen. Because we as leaders and we as pastors and preachers, we do make mistakes.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Let me just say that I won't tell you where all and who all, but as your president, I was able to meet with all of our state auxiliaries and most of our associations, most of them. There were one or two that I did not make it to. It wasn't because I didn't want to, but you know, sometimes older you get all these doctor's appointments and you fail to check your calendar. And some of them, if you reschedule it 6 months later, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. So I'm not getting any younger. But thank God I've been stronger in the Lord. Amen. As your president, my goal has been and still is to bring us together. Somebody will say,
amen.
To bring us together as one, that we might continue to do the work that God has commissioned us to do. Yes. We adopted, many, many years ago, we adopted 3 books to govern us. Robert's Rules of Order. I forget the edition, but Hitchcock. And then the Holy Bible. And the Holy Bible, we accepted the fact that will be and is our ultimate goal.
Amen.
Our ultimate God. Amen. And that being the case, now I'm not wanting to preach. But if the preacher shows up, it'll be all right with me. But I wondered, and this months ago, maybe years ago, I don't know, since last year, what would he have me to say to this West Virginia Baptist State Convention? And I, of course, had been running things through my head, as preachers do. And the Lord stopped me and said, they don't need to hear what you have to say. They need to hear what thus saith the Lord. It's hard to do an address if you're going to tell folks what the Lord says. But I'm going to do my best. There's a scripture that he laid upon my heart.
All right, sir.
Please, I throw no stones at no one. But as we look around, there's a great falling away.
Well,
brothers and sisters, church are leaving and walking away from us. That's true. And he led me to a letter that Paul wrote first. It's found in Corinth. Then hopefully from there you'll understand the address or the message.
All right.
The book of Corinthians, Paul's first letter. Verse 9 and 10. Paul penned these words. He said, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Verse 11, he said to, of course, directly by letter to the church at Corinth, but indirectly to the West Virginia Baptist State Convention.
Well,
he said, now I beseech you, brethren, and that includes sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same language, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Let me pray. It's in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the unction of your Spirit. Pray, O God, that your word will resonate with us. Your word, not comments. I'm just the vessel that you choose at this point in time to use. Let me speak your truth to power. Let the words that flow from my lips and my heart, as led by the Spirit, be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer.
Amen.
In the book of St. John, the Gospel of St. John, chapter 17, we have the recording, the written prayer that Jesus prayed to his Father, and in his prayer, Jesus said to his Father in verse 11, if you choose to turn to chapter 17, but is that, trust me. He said, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me. Notice what he says in that prayer after saying to keep them.
Yeah, right.
He says that they may be one as we are. There's a saying, I very seldom hear it anymore, but there's a saying that we used to say. United we stand, divided we fall. Every family, every organization, every movement struggles with the problems of internal divisions. Oh yeah, I've discovered that not only is there a division on the outside, but there's division on the inside. Many internal conflicts result from a struggle over control. I believe that if everyone would learn to give the Lord control for whatever they are responsible for, many internal divisions can be eliminated. Because without the Lord's leading, there'll always be divisions.
Amen.
United, we stand.
Amen.
As I shared with you in the book of Corinth, Paul, of course, is talking directly to the church. And at this time, that church of Corinth was in a sad state. The fellowship among believers had deteriorated to such a degree that was about to crumble and collapse. There was severe division and dissension in the ranks. There were verbal accusations, differing opinions, competitive positions, power struggles, envy, grumbling, complaining, murmuring, quarreling, attacking, and gossiping. Believers stood against believer, and there was no give-in in any corner. In other words, nobody wanted to give in. Everybody wanted their own way, and nobody could see the other person's point of view, and disaster was about to strike. Now, hear me good. This was the first problem. This was the first problem that Paul had to deal with. He had to deal with it first, because the Bible says a house divided against itself cannot stand.
Amen.
Yeah, I understand. I know that there were other problems, other matters that had to be handled, but the people could not handle them unless the people were brought together in one spirit and one mind. The ministry and mission could not then and cannot now effectively go on until the people stood together.
Amen.
The worship service was affected. The evangelizing ministry was affected. The prayer life of the church and individuals were affected, and their spiritual growth was affected simply because of the divisions that existed in that fellowship.
Well,
brothers and sisters, divisions, y'all probably already know this, but are caused by believers following different leaders. In all of this, the people were guilty of putting the messenger ahead of the message. They were being selfish and creating a me and my a church rather than a Jesus church. The church has split over who the leader should be. And Paul had to bring them back to who the leader really was. Yeah, the leader was and is the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the head of the church. And I pray that he's the head of this West Virginia Baptist State Convention.
Amen.
Jesus said, I know the Bible, but I'm trying not to preach. He said that upon this rock I'll build my church. Now we can run the history. We can look in the archives and we can see how this convention come to be.
All right.
Amen. There were those who felt under the unction of the Spirit and the guidance of God, that we could do more by coming together as one.
That's right.
The Corinthian church had formed cliques around certain men of the church. In one group were the proud pupils of Paul, and another group were the adoring admirers of Apollos. Then there were some who, like Peter, or Cephas, and like always, there were those who claimed to be on nobody's side. And they believed that they were the only true followers of Christ. And I don't know about you, but it sounds like our churches, and some of our churches and conventions and associations today. Division within the fellowship is one of the most serious problems.
Amen.
That a church or association or state convention could ever face.
Amen.
If not the most serious. Divisions can devastate the fellowship.
That's right.
Divisions can devastate the worship. Divisions can devastate the mission, and it can devastate us as witnesses to the world unless it is solved quickly. Does not matter how much you got or we got going for us. division can render us ineffective. Now, the word division is made up of the prefix di, which means two. That's where we get the word divide, which means to split in two. That's where we get the word divorce, which means to make one into two. That's where we get the word dialogue, which means two people speaking with one another. In other words, division means double vision. And if you're seeing two of everything, you need to make a trip to the eye doctor. If there are two visions in the church or the association or the convention, then there needs to be some spiritual doctrine. Oh, bless his name this morning. As an apostle Paul was giving the Corinthians strong advice and recommendation, he's urging them to act upon the preaching and the teaching that he has already given them. And in a very serious manner, Paul said, "Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement that there be no divisions amongst you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose."
All right. That's right.
The church then, the church now, and our convention and associations may be strong, but like them, it has a problem. Church then was wrecked by division. The members of the church were fighting with each other. There were those who were backbiting and backstabbing, others who didn't agree with their point of view. There were people who were murmuring and complaining because things weren't exactly how they would like them to be. There were those who weren't worshiping because the preacher that they wanted or the person that they wanted was not up front, was not up preaching. Although they were in the church, although they are in the convention, the church, the convention was not in them. And that's this was a sign of spiritual immaturity. Paul, oh, there is this church. That all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you. But that you be united in the same mind and with the same purpose. In other words, Paul was saying to them, as he's saying to us through me this morning, united we stand.
That's right.
Divided we will fall.
That's right.
It's Paul's exhortation to the church at Corinth. So I ask today that we allow no dissensions or divisions in our ranks. The word division in the Greek means to split, to tear apart, to break up. This division was not outside the church. It was not in the world, but it was inside the church. The Corinthian church was not working to bring peace, love, and brotherhood to the world. This divided church was not out in the world evangelizing, but it was on the inside, the wall, fuming and fighting. There were cliques in the church.
Well,
y'all know that cliques make a person a man problem.
That's right.
And that's tragic.
That's right.
Because a genuine believer is always baptized in the name of the Lord.
Well,
not in the name of a man. In his or her baptism, the believer confessed the Lord and gave testimony that he or she was committing his or her life to follow the Lord.
All right,
we ought to confess loyalty to the Lord.
Amen.
We are to stand for Christ.
Amen.
And his righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we can easily get our eyes on other folks. We can become followers of men and all women.
Amen.
And not the Lord.
Well,
that's what happened in Corinth. When they lost sight of the Lord Jesus Christ, they began to focus on the personalities around them rather than the person who saved them.
All right.
They began to focus on the leaders of the church instead of the founder of the church. Yeah, they began to focus on what they were getting out of the church instead of what they were putting into the church.
Well,
sounds like some talk you heard, doesn't it? and also get our eyes on the problems. The people of Corinth began to focus on the problems they were facing with others instead of focusing on the problem solver. They began to argue and fuss and even began to take each other to court.
Well,
West Virginia Baptist State Convention, we too can get our eyes onto other problems. Even in our convention, we can often get our eyes on the wrong priorities. The priorities of the Corinthian believers began to be what they desired. They began to live according to their appetites. Thus becoming carnal rather than spiritual people that were supposed to be, that they were supposed to be, and this led to the abuse of spiritual gifts. Whatever spiritual gift you or I have, it didn't originate with us. Hello, somebody. God gave it to you.
Amen.
You are not ever forget to give God the glory and the praise for the gift that he's given to you. I'm not afraid that some of the same situations that existed then are still relevant today. Paul will have us see that not only are such divisions contrary to the gospel, but they should be set aside by the gospel. I will let you know this morning that our priority should always be to be what God wants us to become. We ought not be the same today as we were yesterday. And we ought not to be the same come tomorrow as we are today. We ought not be divided because we have one Messiah and one Savior. We have one Lord, not two Lords. One faith, not two faiths. One baptism, not two baptisms. Our convention ought not be divided because we have one mission. And that is to go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Our fellowship ought not be divided because we have one message. And it is the message of the cross. Paul says, "For I'm determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified." Oh, bless his name. Oh, I need to tell you today, West Virginia Baptist Convention,
yes, sir.
We're being watched. When we become angry and divided, we're not only robbed of our joy, we're robbed of our effectiveness. When we lack unity, our credibility is worthless. Our testimonies are useless. Our example are a waste of time. The gospel is good news. But there is no good news in fussing and fighting. The reality is God designed the church of today. And he knew that the church would be filled with imperfect people. But a church filled with imperfect people needed to learn how to get along, how to forgive one another, how to die to self, how to live for Christ and then process, mature in the faith for the glory of the kingdom of God. Not only, thank you, to be hearers of the word, but to be doers of that word. Well, how then can we proclaim reconciliation to others when we are not ourselves reconciled? How can we tell the world that the wages of sin is death? when we are busy trying to destroy one another.
Yeah.
How can we tell the world to unite when we remain disunited?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Sister Dodson. God created the world out of nothing. And as long as we realize that we are nothing, God can make something out of nothing. Therefore, God can make something out of us. We must realize today that without God, you nor I can do nothing. Without God, we will fail. Without God, our lives will be rugged. Like a ship without a sail. Let us know this morning that together we stand, but divided we fall. And if we wish to stand against Satan, then the convention needs to remain united. Ecclesiastes 4:12, I'm closing, says, though one may be overpowered by another. Get ready, buddy.
Yes.
Two can withstand him.
Yes, Lord.
And a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Yeah.
There's strength and unity in numbers.
Yeah.
And if, as our executive director has asked of us, if we desire to impact our communities, our cities, our world, then we must stand together. I heard the psalmist say, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. As I go to my seat, I got three things I want to leave with you. Number one, don't lose your promotion. Don't let pride stand in your way. Don't let your own self-importance get in the way of the Lord's priority for the convention. Number two, don't lose your comprehension. In other words, keep the big picture the big picture. Yeah, we're about Jesus. Our hope is in Jesus. Our hope is not in progress, but our hope is in the Lord. We are to bring glory to his name. Now I'm about to tell you when to give God some glory. For the Bible says that neither is there salvation in any other, except the name of Jesus. So any man saved, every now and then because of your salvation, you ought to just want to give God some glory.
Yeah.
Number three, don't lose your commission.
Yeah,
our mission is to proclaim Christ.
Yeah.
Our mission is to live for Christ.
Yeah.
In other words, we got to let our audio, our video, match our audio. We gotta live and become new creatures that God has created us to be.
Yes!
Yes. We have a charge to keep. And God to glorify. Every dying soul to save and fit for the sky. Thank you, men and women, preachers and lay people, for expounding all this year on the theme. We must redeem the time. So we got to redeem the time. We got to be able to be an effective witness. Can I get one witness in the house today? We must be able to tell a dying well that one evening Jesus died and don't get caught up in whether it was Friday or Thursday.
Through a day so There is a God who again, Paul.